One of the defining features of this course and of our text is a consideration of the dynamics of global inequality. But what do we mean by this? And why is global inequality important in understanding the politics and development of the Third World? This is a composite satellite image of the Earth at night. What does it tell us about development? A lot, I think. Note the areas lit up at night. While Europe, the United States, and Japan are clearly visible, much of the global south remains in the dark, both figuratively and literally. A handful of very large cities, Cairo, Johannesburg, Rio de Janeiro, Mexico City, and Beijing, and others are visible. But large portions of South America, Africa, and Asia, outside of India, are not. And more broadly, the use of lights highlights energy consumption and the availability of electricity. And as this slide suggests, many countries in the developing world are net energy exporters, supplying more oil, natural gas, and other energy exports to the rest of the world than they consume themselves. Here we see two cartograms. The one on the left shows world population by region. The one on the right shows world wealth by region. Note the differences between the two. Africa and South Asia figure prominently on the cartogram on the left, but virtually disappear from the one on the right. What does this suggest about development? There are at least three dimensions of global inequality that divide global north and global south. The first is economic. Since 1960, the ratio of wealth between the richest quintile and the poorest quintile has increased from 30 to 1 to 71. Over the same period, the global Gini coefficient, a measure of wealth distribution and inequality, has increased markedly. Today, the top 20% of the world's population control 80% of the world's income, consume half of all the energy used, eat half the meat produced in the world, and is responsible for 80% of all CO2 emissions. Intra-country inequality is also increasing. Today, there are neighborhoods in the global south that would easily fit into the wealthiest suburbs of the United States, and there are pockets of poverty in the United States that would be at home in the global south. Such poverty and inequality have real implications. Countries with higher levels of economic inequality usually have shorter overall life expectancies and lower adult literacy rates, for example. There is also a high level of political inequality between developed and developing countries. Developing countries often have considerably less bargaining power in international forums like the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, and the World Bank. Developing countries also tend to be underrepresented in global civil society, having fewer non-governmental organizations representing their interests. As a result, international negotiations tend to focus disproportionately on northern issues. Until the most recent round of the World Trade Organization talks, for example, development was rarely an issue of central concern. Instead, negotiations tended to focus on agenda items like intellectual property rights and trade and services. Similarly, in many international organizations, developing countries tend to be rule takers rather than rule setters, and often lack the capacity to influence policy in the same way more powerful countries can. There is also a high degree of ecological inequality in the world. While many of the world's primary ecological challenges result from economic activity in the global north, the global south disproportionately bears the costs of environmental degradation. There are many examples of this. In the area of climate change, the global north is responsible for the vast majority of greenhouse gas emissions historically. But the primary impact of climate change, sea level rise, desertification, and so on, impact the global south, particularly those countries least able to undertake adaptive measures. The toxic trade often sees hazardous wastes exported to the developing world, and pesticides banned in the global north are widely marketed in developing countries. Indeed, one of the most fascinating exchanges ever to come out of the World Bank focused precisely on this question. In an internal memo in 1991, then World Bank Vice President Lawrence Summers argued, quote, I think that the economic logic behind dumping a load of toxic waste in the lowest wage country is impeccable, and we should face up to that. I've always thought that the underpopulated countries in Africa are vastly underpolluted. Their air quality is probably vastly inefficiently low. The memo was leaked to the media in 1992, prompting a media firestorm. But perhaps the most interesting response was issued by Brazil's Minister of Environment, José Lutzenberger, who wrote that, quote, "Your reasoning is perfectly logical, but totally insane. Your thoughts provide a concrete example of the unbelievable alienation, reductionist thinking, social ruthlessness, and the arrogance of many conventional economists concerning the nature of the world we live in. If the World Bank keeps you on as vice president, it will lose all credibility. To me, it would confirm what I often have said. The best thing that could happen for the bank, the best thing that could happen would be for the bank to disappear." What happened as a result of this exchange? Lutzenberger was fired, and Summers served out his term, later becoming president of Harvard University, secretary of the Treasury under Bill Clinton, and director of the White House Economic Council of Economic Advisors under Barack Obama. By what logic could Summers argue that Africa is underpolluted, and there is a real economic logic of dumping toxic waste in poor countries? From a purely economic perspective, Summers is right, but this demonstrates the limits of a purely economic understanding of development.